and how to kind of try to describe it to them. I found over time it's really difficult for people to understand it.
It's just very complicated with this tiredness, the cataplexy, the fragmented sleep at night.
If you're a normal person, you've got sleep and you've got your waking life, and occasionally they'll overlap a little bit. Mm-hmm. For me, I live in this world that is very rarely am I fully awake and very rarely am I fully asleep. I live in the in-between.
I'm Tom Scammell. I'm a professor of neurology at Harvard Medical School. Narcolepsy is a neurologic disorder. It is one of the most common sleep disorders. It affects about 1 in 2,000 people. Doesn't matter how much sleep they get at night, they're gonna feel sleepy every day. People also can have a variety of other symptoms. These include hypnagogic hallucinations, where they can have very vivid dreamlike hallucinations just as they're drifting off to sleep or just when they awaken. They can have something called sleep paralysis, where as they're falling asleep or sometimes when they wake up, they can't move. And then there's cataplexy, which is similar to sleep paralysis. The distinction is that cataplexy occurs right in the middle of the day and it's triggered by strong emotions. And then the last thing, which is perhaps sort of one of the strangest of all, is that, you know, for considering that somebody with narcolepsy is often very sleepy through the day, they often have fragmented sleep at night. They can wake up 4 or 5 times for 10 or 20 minutes for no clear reason. And so in the same way that they have trouble maintaining wakefulness through the day, they can have trouble maintaining sleep through the night. Somewhere between age 10 and age 20 or so is when narcolepsy begins. People usually start off with sleepiness and then the other symptoms follow. So there's a number of different systems in the brain that are involved in promoting arousal or wakefulness and sleep. Up here's the cortex. This is the front near the forehead. Here's the back. This is the brainstem coming down here. And this is the cerebellum, which is involved in balance. The brainstem is the site that most of these arousal-promoting signals come from. And those cells send connections up throughout the whole front part of the brain, and they help turn on the cortex and other parts of the brain when you're awake. There's also some cells in a small region called the hypothalamus that are involved in promoting sleep. And these sleep-promoting cells, one of the things they do is they actually turn off the wake-promoting cells. And so that allows you to be fully asleep without any hint of consciousness. This is called the mammillary body. And just above it, right here, is where the hypocretin neurons sit. And this is a really critical collection of neurons, brain cells, that makes very particular and special neurotransmitters known as hypocretin or orexin. Those are just two names for the same thing. The hypocretin-producing cells help activate and sustain activity in the other wake-promoting brain regions across the day. The brain contains billions of neurons, and only a very, very small number of these produce hypocretin. It's probably somewhere between 100,000 and 200,000, which sounds like a large number But when you compare it to 10 billion neurons, it's really very small. In narcolepsy, those hypocretin-producing cells die off. When you look closely at the brain of somebody who has narcolepsy, what you see is about a 90 to 95% loss of the hypocretin-producing neurons. So there's two broad themes that are being pursued in narcolepsy research right now. One theme is to understand what goes wrong in the brain when the hypocretin-producing cells die off. How does that lead to sleepiness and cataplexy and other symptoms? Another big theme is trying to understand what actually kills the hypocretin neurons in the first place. Because if we could understand that, then it's possible that if one could diagnose and recognize narcolepsy right at the earliest stages, we might be able to get in and stop that process. As we've discovered more and more about what's actually causing the hypocretin neurons to die off, and as we've discovered more about the consequences of that for the brain, it's really given us a lot of hope for new opportunities for coming up with better therapies for people with narcolepsy. If we could get hypocretin back in the brain somehow, that would be potentially as great as giving insulin to people with diabetes. It would really be the missing factor coming back into play, and it could, in theory, cure their sleepiness and cure their cataplexy in the most thorough fashion. Right now, scientists are working with a variety of techniques to try to get hypocretin signaling back into the brain. But the hope is that in 5, 10, or 15 years, we may see those hypocretin replacement therapies coming into clinical practice.